How many of you are staying in the hotel? This hotel right here. Oh, cool. Did you see Channel 47 last night? Wasn't that awesome? Channel 47, it was some, one of the best shows I've seen in a while. Channel 47, I was rapt. Now, I couldn't make this out either, but it says, it's almost as blurry as you see it here. Blah, blah, blah. This is some kind of path, but I could barely make it out. Is not a valid Win32 application. So this was Saturday. Sunday. Sometimes, as testers, we find bugs without even trying. Flipping through the channels looking for the Cinderella bedtime story for my 2-year-old daughter. And she is, you know, focused on the TV, daddy, daddy. And I'm like, wait, honey, wait, wait. Monday. Notice the title bar now. PowerPoint, slideshow. PowerPoint, space, slide, space, show. PowerPoint. Okay, now as a journalist, I'm thinking there's a story here that is a bug that's emerging, right? There's a context. What have you heard so far? It's on the TV, it's channel 47, started on Saturday, right? Well, I first noticed it on Saturday. 24 hours or so later, it's hard for me to remember, the second one, Monday. So, what happens today? There is a fourth. I just haven't uploaded it to my, I have an iPhone so I can go click. So, Rob Sabrin mode kicks in. Ethics. Tell somebody. This is a problem. This is embarrassing for Disney. Now, is there any IT people in the room for Disney? Please let them, I mean, I'm trying to talk to you, and I can't. I penetrated the Disney fortress. I haven't managed to penetrate. So I go to the front desk, right? And I start telling them the story. Okay. And you may have had this experience too. Sorry, I'm getting out my notebook, my reporter's notebook. Oh, Debbie was her name. So I told her the story, and I showed, I have a tablet PC, so I'm really, really excited. I flipped it open, and I put it on tablet mode, and I showed her. And she said, I will send a technician to the room. Debbie, bless your heart. Have a magic day, she said. Have a magic day. It will be magical when they fix it, yes. Have a magical day. Debbie was actually more of service than that. She listened to my problem, okay? And I'm a reporter, right? And I'm a tester. And I'm trying to tell her the details, the context. And she nodded, but she didn't take out a notebook or pen or write any of this down. But she got on the phone, and she called technical services. And I knew that wasn't it. It's not my TV. He's having a problem accessing something on his PC. No, it's on the TV. So she handed me, next to her, Melanie overheard her. Okay? Melanie says, no, he needs the IT people. I'm like, yes. Ah, finally, someone technically competent. I showed it to her, and she calls up. He's seeing an error message on his PC. Well, yes, it's on my PC, but this is a picture. This is a picture of the television. He says it's a picture on his television. Yes. Did you see if the cable was plugged in to your television? No. Put me on the phone. And she does. Thank you for Melanie. Yeah, no, it's not my TV. It's, yeah, no, Saturday. Yeah, it's probably an exception that's been, yeah. Okay. So, no, it's not on my laptop. Okay, so he asked me to hand it back to her. Melanie said, is there anyone there that programs the television station? I didn't hear the answer. She said, no, who does the thing to the software? And I wrote it down. I'm like, oh, this is gold. I'm at a testing conference. And she mentioned the cable connection again. And, can you send someone to his room to get it sorted out? And I closed the notebook and I said, I gotta go. Thank you, you've been more than helpful to the service. So, telling your exploratory story. This story does not have a script to it, although it does now, because I just read it to you. I was gonna start my keynote with a totally different thing. And until I got here on Saturday, and I thought, that's cool, maybe I'll use it in one of my other talks, like bug investigation I did on Monday, or session-based exploratory testing I did yesterday. But the more this emerged, day after day after day, I got more excited. So I wanted to lead with that, because the story's still unfolding, right? So I have a confession to make. Yes, I'm a journalism major, and I've run into my testing career, I've hired many testers. And my favorite testers to interview are those who have liberal arts backgrounds, creative sciences degrees, because they are creative, they think, they imagine, right? They're communication majors, okay? And I find that when they have CS degrees, this is not a slam against you if you have a CS degree, but I see a tendency there that you want the software to work usually, where, and you've got some ideas, that's fine, this is the tendency that I see. But the imagination part of it, being here at Disneyland especially, you're surrounded by by Walt Disney's imagination. That's the important part to me. If my imagination fails me as a tester, I'm done. I just feel like I can't compete with James, my brother, I can't compete with Michael Bolton. They're my heroes. If there was a testing super friends, a hall of justice, you know, I don't know what my superpower is. James tells me, you're one of the best test managers I've ever seen. You're a coach. You're the coach. You're the guy in the trenches. I don't know if he's right. It's fun to teach like this. But I know from journalism that testing is a story formed by following up on things. It could be a tip, a lead, a rumor, a conjecture. You ever be flipping through the channels and you hit the Fox News channel or something like that? And you'll see a headline on the crawler, on the ticker, and they'll say something really salacious, but it'll have a question mark on it. So it's not them saying it, they're saying, what if the stock market was a conspiracy? Is the stock market a conspiracy by liberals? Question mark. Well, it starts with a conjecture, right? I can just change liberals to conservatives, and I can go off on my own conjectures, right? So it starts off with a conjecture or some question, right? Well, in pursuit of the truth, that's the point. And I don't know how you feel about Fox News, but I have some feelings about that, but my ethic as a tester is, what is the truth? What's going on? So it also involves consulting sources and references, things that we call oracles. An oracle is something that tells you the right answer, because every problem is this simple. You have a desire, and you have what really happens. And there's space in the middle. You put them together, there's no problem. Change your desire. It's not a bug, it's a feature. Right? It's by design. Or you change your actual. We fix the bug. We got a new API, don't worry, it's going to be fixed. Okay? Anytime they're different, that by definition should excite you as testers. Okay, so oracles. What is the right answer? Now, in journalism, there's this thing called the AP style guide, the Associated Press style guide. So if I want to know what the correct format is of saying AM or PM, is it capital AM? Is it capital A dot capital M dot? AP style guide is my oracle for that kind of thing. But it also requires communication to an audience. Rob Sabin mentioned this. Who is your audience? Because they're going to either scrutinize or trust your work. If you haven't met your stakeholders, they don't trust you yet. they extend you trust credit, and I got this from my brother. I really think that's really important. They extend you trust credit, that you either increase your credit line or you get a lower credit line based on the quality of your work. Let me tell you another unfolding story. This is an Alaska 737-200. I forgot the tail number, but it's an actual airplane, as you can see. Well, of course it's an actual airplane, John. I say that because there's a story behind this, but that's the actual airplane. So a couple of years ago, Flight 61 took off from runway 34 right instead of the assigned runway 34 at Seattle, where I'm from. There were no injuries to the passengers and no damage to the airplane. And the airplane was operating under the provisions of 14 CFR Part 21, which just means they're a certified air carrier. That's all that means. And continued uneventfully to its destination of Juneau, Alaska. I can't think of a more boring story to tell at a keynote than that. Everybody was happy, you know. And in fact, you know, the flight data recorder, you know, it didn't even get cracked open. So where's the sexy part of this story? Well, somebody thought it was sexy because there was a report was filed about this. This is a preliminary report, NTSB, National Transportation Safety Board report. And I'm thinking, when I saw this, what earthly reason is there to file a report like this? Any ideas? They didn't follow proper procedure, okay. So I'm saying that it's a story of emerging events filed by officials, you, for some purpose. For example, the government may be collecting statistics on runway incursions. So if you're not following procedure, right, they're potentially deadly. Or the pilots or the ground controllers, they've got a record, right? So they can be reprimanded or dismissed for that sort of thing. So you want to figure out over time, how often is this happening? No damage to the airplane, nobody got hurt. Or it could be signage. You need a record of the event. Maybe there's another accident waiting to happen, okay? So again, a story is unfolding here that it's still unfolding literally with this one. I haven't done any follow-up yet. If I was a journalist, I'd be like, okay, how many times has this happened since then? Okay, I have to ask some questions. I got to consult some sources. I got to figure out what's going on. Just like when we see Channel 47, and we see a crash, well, that's interesting. And the next day there's two dialogues, and the next day there's three dialogues, and I don't want to tell them, actually. I want to see what happens when it gets to be like 28 dialogue. Oh, wait, even better, 32 dialogues. What happens at 32 dialogues? Is there something at, But anyway, I don't have any confidence they're going to fix it anyway, given my experience this morning. So just keep watching Channel 47 if you can, and you'll be up in the story. Here's another unfolding story. What are you looking at here? Looks like a big green blob. You see the lines, barely? Looks like a chain link fence, doesn't it? And I say looks like because you could be wrong. Now, my brother taught me many things, but safety language or trap avoidance is another thing he taught me. Don't say, well, yeah, it's a chain link fence. Say it seems to be a chain link fence. It could be. It appears as if. That way, if you're wrong, hey, I said it appears to be. Seems to be. It could be. I could be wrong, right? Journalists, same thing. They ask more than one source, right? Because that source could mislead them. Here's emerging context. There's a little sign that says fly. Ah, chain link fence, maybe at an airport. That's kind of cool, all right? Framed by reference. Reference is an important part of things, as I've been mentioning. So now it says learn to fly. Now we know we're at an airport, right? Or we have a high degree of likelihood it's an airport. So I heard my brother say, maybe the sign on the fence was upside down and the plane is right side up. That's why I love my brother. He like helps me become a better tester in so many ways just by throwaway comments like that. I'll use that now in my next talk. So, but look at inference. We're not done yet. You're probably wondering, what the? It's a blue, well, not blue sky, but it looks like it's not a windy hurricane. What happened? Was it you touched the brakes too hard? I was raised around airplanes. In fact, one of the stories about me that is totally irrelevant to this, although I'm making it relevant because I say I'm a journalist and I'm a writer, is because my dad is also a writer, and he's an author, as a matter of fact. And he wrote a book that I'm named after called Jonathan Livingston Seagull. So my first name, to many of you, has been John for years, J-O-N. But it's short for Jonathan. And so my dad wrote a very famous book. And I think I've got the writing gene. And as a tester, I use it every day. I communicate, like Rob Sabrin was saying, to that audience. That's one of my stories. Now, we all have stories that we're carrying around inside of us. We're happy, sad, mad. We're distracted, some of us today, you know. And especially in a job interview, my job is to find out what your stories are, especially your weaknesses, because I want to know, can I trust you, you know. So I use reference and inference. But Dad taught me something when I was working on a book, actually about he and I, which is another story I don't know if I'll go into. He told me, every story is this simple. Think as a tester now. Every bug or every test report could be this simple. Somebody wants something. Something stands in their way. This is what they do about it. This little aphorism changed my life because I've been testing it for years and I haven't found it to fail. Every story. Furthermore, he said, take away any one element of that triad, you got no story. You're doing it now, aren't you? You're trying to take away any one element. Oh, I'll take away the third one. I bet everyone's taken away the first one. You're thinking to yourself, I want to take away the third one. Is there still a story? Let's try it. Somebody wants something. Nothing stands in their way. This is what they do about it? So the runway incursion. Somebody wants something. I want to get to Juneau, Alaska. Nothing stands in my way. I land safely. I guess I don't have to do anything about it. So somebody wants something. Something stands in the way. There was a runway incursion. We clipped another wing of an airplane. What am I going to do about it? What a story that would be. So you see what I mean? That little formula. I'm looking for formulas like that all the time. So bugs. Somebody wants something. I want to watch Channel 47, put on some nice music for my 2-year-old daughter. Something stands in the way. I see these crash. What do I do about it? That's still a story that's unfolding. And again, it's exploratory. I don't know what I'm going to want to do or attempt before I see the context. Here's another boring story. These guys, does anyone know who these guys are? Just raise your hand. Wow, I'm impressed at that. Good. These are three astronauts. They went into space. They came back home safely. End of story. Somebody wanted something, they wanted to go into space. Something stood in their way, well, nothing stood in their way, they came back safely. Right, they're all safe, look, they're on the carrier. Anybody know who these guys are now? Show of hands, show of hands. Good, more people. They are the Apollo 13 astronauts. They left the Earth April 11th, 1970. They get more than halfway to the moon. On day two, they do a routine stir of the cryo tanks, which has liquid oxygen and hydrogen mixed together, because in space, fluids don't flow so well, so they have to heat it up and pressurize it, and that's how they get the flow of oxygen and for the batteries, for the fuel cells. Bang. So they reported a problem. What's the famous line? Houston, we have a problem. Actually, here's the transcript. I thought that too. Houston, we have a problem. So CC is Capcom. Thank you. Capsule Communications. Thank you. 13, we've got one more little item for you. When you get a chance, we'd like you to stir up your cryo tanks. In addition, I have Shaft and Trunnion. Shaft and Trunnion, by the way, is the angles to view this comet that they're going to look at. And they say, okay, for looking at Comet Bennett, if you need it. Okay, stand by. Okay, Houston. Commander, I believe we've had a problem here, is the actual quote. This is Houston. Say again, please. Houston, we've had a problem. We've had a main B bus undervolt. Roger, main B undervolt. Okay, stand by, 13. We're looking at it. My brother and I had a really cool idea years and years ago to do testing, exploratory testing, real-time, simultaneous test execution and design with a focus on learning with headsets. Remember that? And we were just going to do this, like simulate all these cool bugs. We've had a problem, and James would say, I'm on it, you know? And be like, okay, you know, look at the telemetry, and that's a quadruple failure. That can't happen. You know, those kind of sexy things that get me, you know, fired up like Rob Sovereign, like, you know, wow, this is... Okay, now if you've seen Apollo 13, the movie, and if you haven't, I recommend you do. It is one of the best testing movies I can recommend to you. Or look at the transcripts, go online and read them. There's audio too, which is beautiful. I couldn't play it because I couldn't get it to work. So they had all these problems that unfolded over their journey to the moon. Their carbon dioxide was rising, and they had to replace the canisters. But so they basically, it's like this. The command module is shaped like a round cylinder with a nose cone, and on the end is the LEM, or the lunar excursion module, and it's shaped like, you know, like a spider kind of thing, right? And they're joined together, right? So the command module, they stir the cryotanks, boom, and it starts losing power. So they had to make the LEM into a lifeboat. Well, both of them have the problem of CO2 rising because people breathe, right, and they expend CO2. So, but the thing is, the CO2 filters in the LEM were circular, and the CO2 canisters in the command module were square. So they couldn't just put in new filters. So they had to make one in space. They also had to come up with a new procedure for powering up a cold command module, because by the fourth or fifth day in space, the command module is ice cold because it doesn't have any power to heat itself. So that was new. They had to find enough amperage because there wasn't enough amperage because the battery cells were dying. They had to hit the reentry corridor just right. If they go in too shallow, they skip off. If they go in too deep, they burn up like a meteor. There was a chance that their heat shield could have been damaged because of the explosion, which protects them in reentry. And in the movie, there was some allusion to a hurricane, and I didn't see any evidence of that in the transcripts in 1970. So that was another problem they had to... So I have to, as a journalist, I would say, was there really a hurricane? Maybe it's just a movie thing, but I didn't see any evidence of that. Okay, so let me tie it back to the story. In your project, you have characters, you have purpose, you have conflict, and you have actions. Those are the four main elements. So Apollo 13, you know who the characters are. The purpose, after the explosion anyway, the purpose changed. That's exploratory testing right there, is dynamic adaption to a problem. You know about the conflict, and you know what they did. There's your story. All right, let's talk about us. Remember, somebody wants something, something stands in their way, this is what they do about it. So somebody, some stakeholder, wants something like, how stable are these new features? Something is in the way, like limited budget and time. And I know, I could say, ask the usual speaker question, how many of you have had unlimited budget and unlimited time, and we never do? So I put that in as a gimme, right? That's conflict all the time. In actions. What do we do as testers? We expose risks, we use certain techniques and approaches, we cover the product. That's one thing we can do about it, is just check it out. Okay, take any historical explorer for that matter, Lewis and Clark, Magellan, Vasco da Gama, Columbus, you pick. We all do the same things, those historical explorers and we testers. We observe, we come up with conjectures, and we talk about project information, you know, objective information. The first one is subjective somewhat, right? Drawings of plants and flowers, and we do feature models. Okay? The second one is totally subjective. Conjectures. The explorer may ask, well, how do we get there? Lewis and Clark's mission was not to just discover the Pacific Northwest after the Louisiana Purchase, which I thought it was. Just like, oh, go out and get to the Pacific Ocean somehow. No, they were given a specific mission by Thomas Jefferson saying, by its course and communication with the mouth of the Missouri River and such principal stream of it, find a navigable, practicable water route to the Pacific Ocean for the purposes of commerce. So they failed in their mission, didn't they? There is no practical water route from Missouri to the Pacific Ocean. So was that a failure? Because look at all the stuff they found. Okay, again, their trip journals are online. They're fascinating reads. I've got some excerpts and some talks that I do about it. So why am I talking to you? Because especially, well, testers are fighting for respect. Forget the exploratory tester part, but testers are fighting for respect. But I'm my passion and my hobby, if you will, in this career, is exploration. So I've learned as a coach and a manager that we especially have to fight for respect. So, and it's hard because we don't often know how to describe our thinking, and that's a critical problem. Because our credibility is on the line. We're just known as the guys who play around with the software. You know, playing around, messing around, you know, sloppy. Plus we have the documentation dilemma, that there's this insistence that all testing be documented. So exploratory testers, well, actually, let me clarify something. I'm struggling with something right now. I don't know if there is a term exploratory tester. Because even when you're running a test case, you're exploring. You are. Even if the first item on the test case is enter the number 300, I'm going to guess that there's a little part of you that says, 300. 300.00. Can I do that? Right, you're thinking, not allowed. Not allowed. You're running a test case. You're running a test case. Stop it. Now, I made this mistake. Here's yet another reference to my brother, who I love dearly. I was helping him on a court case, and I was running some test cases because we were helping our client. And I was running some test cases, and I was, you know, doing that. I was like, I wonder if I do this. And he got really mad at me. You remember this? And he said, don't think. Don't think. The more you think, the more opposing counsel is going to drive a truck right through my testimony. Mr. Bach, did you or did you not improvise during this test case? Well, yeah, sure. Ah, I rest my case. You did not follow the steps exactly, did you, Mr. Bach? Did you answer the question, Mr. Bach? I didn't want to put him through that, so I felt horrible. I'm like, I will try to follow the steps. 300, okay, I'm sorry. And I couldn't do it because I didn't know what was accepted. I mean, some of the language wasn't written in a way that was absolutely objective, that a machine could do it. And we're not machines. If I gave you the same test case, every person, 980 of you, however many there are, I bet I would learn something as I walked around and watched each of you run that test case. And you would make some profound mistakes, I bet. Some new test cases or new test ideas would come up. Your work will be scrutinized. That's another problem. That's why I'm doing this talk. Because as a manager, I have to be accountable to the people above me. And I know how to handle that. Well, I'm practicing. But I, for the most part, I know what they're going to ask me. So that's why I'm going to try to help you know how to handle me, what I'm going to ask you. For example, your audience. This slide was not in the deck about a half hour ago. Because I was listening to Rob Zabern's talk. I'm like, how can I do a talk about telling your exploratory story? I don't even have a slide about my audience. So in an exploratory way, I learned and adapted and stuck this in from another deck that I had. I have to talk about audience. He mentioned triage, absolutely. The project manager's there, sales and marketing is there, the test manager's there, the dev manager, documentation, release manager, localization. They're all different audiences. Rob Sabrin said seven different. Well, you see eight of them there. So your story will be interpreted differently by different people. I'm in triage now at LexisNexis. I'm a senior QA manager, as Lee mentioned. I just started last month with them. And triage is so much fun. I get so many cool ideas from triage because customer support, they're going to say, no one's reporting this. We shouldn't waste time fixing it. And there are times when we want to say, oh, deferred, and customer support says, wait. There's one customer who is going to kill us if we don't fix this. One customer? Come on. Yeah, well, they're a multi-billion dollar client. Sorry. Who is it now? Context. As a reporter, I'm like, woohoo, I got to learn more about this client. I want to talk to them. Therefore, respect. I want to talk a little bit about my antidote to the playing around perception. I want to help you use labels for the skills and tactics that testers practice during exploration. Not that they need to practice them, because, well, I believe they do, but they do practice them. They just don't realize that they're doing it. I'll talk about a way to make it manageable and measurable and accountable, this exploratory testing stuff, right? And I'll talk about what I want from my testers and how I prepare. Did you make this up, James? Yeah. Again, the second he stops being profound in his talks, is the second I'll stop listening to him. Again, another thing from James that I can just quote now. And I had the same reaction you did when I saw his slides. He says my slides are cool, but he's got the quotes, man. Look at that. I even highlighted those words because that's what struck me. And maybe that was his point. I've never actually asked you, James, what is. But exactly. No wonder testing is so hard. Someone challenged me on this slide, by the way, and said, invisible, it's not invisible. You can see it, it's right there on the screen. And I said, what if you don't have it on the screen? Well, it's in your head. It's a wireframe, it's a spec. You haven't seen it yet. Well, I'm gonna see it. Yeah, you are. It may be totally different by the time it gets to you. One example I could think of in the moment, I was kind of on the spot. I'm like, ooh, wait, yeah, hey, wait a minute. So I had to think about it, so. This is from Kem Kaner. And it's also from the Exploratory Testing Research Summit that a bunch of us in the audience were at, some colleagues, Scott Barber, Elizabeth Hendrickson, Jonathan Cole, my brother, and me. And we all were practicing exploratory testing and doing keynotes like this, and we said, can't we kind of get on the same page maybe about what we're saying about exploratory? What's interesting about what we're all saying about exploratory testing in our talks? And we came up with our own definitions of what we thought it was, and we had different definitions, although not like majorly different. But there's some similarities. And we all like Chem's the best because it resonated with most of our definitions. Learning. Learning. Doesn't seem like it's testing, is it? But it's when you adapt to emerging context, like driving a car. They're never going to automate that. Pedestrians, weather, potholes, traffic. I don't want them to automate that stuff. I wouldn't trust it. My other brother's an airline captain. And I see the cockpit and I go, man, look at all this automation. Actually, I know better. I say, look at all this computer assistance. Because it's not really, sometimes we don't use full-on automation. Sometimes we just use a little tool to help us in our cognition, don't we? Computer-assisted testing. And I want him in the cockpit, right? I want him adapting to weather and emergencies in the airplane and emergencies on the ground that affect his flight path. I want him in the cockpit. But I also don't want him and only him in the cockpit. I want him to have machines to help him fly the airplane, like radar and TCAS, terrain and avoidance collision detection system, I think. I want him to have instruments to help him. All right, so I alluded to the skills and tactics. There's a mnemonic that I remember this as, Mr. Q Comp, Gorab C, R&R. I think this is an old slide. I'm forgetting. Oh, no, it is. No, this is a new one, because pairing is now collaboration. So I remember all these skills and tactics that you do. I know you do them, because I've seen you do them. Not you specifically. Well, in some cases, I have seen you specifically. But I'm going to bet, if you worked for me, I could say, you're not playing around. You're modeling. You're taking stock of what's there. You're representing the product in your own way, your own perception of what it is. What's in the file menu, for example? Does print have an ellipsis after the menu item? What if it doesn't? That's a model. That's a risk, perhaps. Chartering, making missions for ourselves when we explore. My mission for this Channel 47 thing was to figure out how to help Disneyland not look so silly. Okay? That's my mission. And I gave myself a half hour this morning to go to the front desk and finally start to solve this problem. Chartering. I gave myself that charter. So I'm not just making up anything I want and just kind of going with it. It's structured. I have a tactic. Although I did kind of make it up, but it's not like it's changing every 3 seconds. Recording versus reporting. I'll end with those and on this slide. What's the difference, you might ask? Recording is what you usually do for you. You can use recording tools, record and playback or whatever. You can do a screen capture, alt print screen, right? You can take notes. In fact, hey, wait a minute. You've got some notebooks, don't you? Isn't that interesting? At a testing conference, they give you notebooks and pens and paper to write down thoughts that you may never see again. But you're going to react to different things as you go through the conference. You may even have to give a report at the end of the conference to your stakeholders. Reporting, then, is what you do for them. Recording is usually what you do for you. Like a flight data recorder. You don't crack it open if you land safely. Okay? But you may crack it open if there's an accident and have to deliver a little NTSB report, right? Two different skills. All right. I think I have time to do this. Reporting in action. Let's see if this is going to work. One of these years at STAR, I think it was 2004, Lee Copeland asked us, my brother and I, to do a testing demo. Testing, like, try to outthink James and I, right? We're two of the most famous exploratory speakers and practitioners, we think. So we're trying to be of service to you and elevate our game. So Lee came up with the title, Testing Outside the Box, B-A-C-H-S. So I thought, oh, Lee, how corny. Jeez. And James is like, I came up with that title, dude. I was like, oh, sorry. So, but we wanted you to outthink us, basically. But our idea was this. Let's make an exploratory demo, like, play-by-play. You know, like a sporting event. And so we wanted to do something like this. Like, let's pretend James is doing this right now. And I'm narrating. I'm like, James. Okay, right now, James looks like it's... just starting off, he's got his mission, and you know that's called chartering. It looks like he's got a good solid charter for this round. He's got his notepad open. Looks like his lab procedures are going to be pretty good because he's got a way to organize his thoughts. His first test looks like a conformance test. And it looks like he wanted an equilateral. Looks like he got the equilateral. He's got 2-2-2. I don't know why he's doing that. Looks like an equivalence class to me. And then I would throw it to James for color. You know, what you got to remember about that, John, is James is a key player. You know, he always goes to the conformance test at the bottom of the hour, you know, something like that, right? Color commentary, play-by-play, never before seen at STAR. We had a ball doing it. He put me on the hot seat on an application I hadn't seen until the night before called Friends and Family. And I had a ball because I'm ready for scrutiny. I was, you know, James helps me get ready for all kinds of stakeholders who may say, why are you doing that? Why am I paying you? What's your value? So here I am doing recording and reporting at the same time. I'm trying to go back and catch the typos, but you see, reproduce a condition that's misspelled. So I'm sorry. My report isn't that polished. Back to the play-by-play. So here I am. I'm having conjectures. I'm consulting oracles, geometry. The lengths of two smaller sides must be greater than the third for the triangle to be legitimate. Yes, it looks like he's got a good notion of an oracle on that one. That's going to help him in the later rounds. Right? Looks like he's got a conjecture there. Are decimals allowed? He's going with the ones, and he's doing a 0.9. Interesting choice. We'll find out why after the game. It may hurt him later, but we'll see. Oh, 0.99. Oh, was that a comma? Looks like he made a comma. I'm confused. He's got a decimal on the screen. He's got a comma in his notes. I'm not sure what he's thinking there, ladies and gentlemen. He's now in the 1.4. We don't know what's in his head yet. We'll hopefully find out. Looks like he's only changing one factor at a time. I think that was called an OFAT test back in 1963 in the Helsinki Games. OFAT, one factor at a time. That's a useful heuristic. How many places he's thinking, and on it would go. I think if we could do our testing this way, the management would get excited about our work. Although it is kind of granular, I'm only testing this little app at this time. But telling your exploratory story, modeling, conjecturing, branching, backtracking, reporting versus recording, all these highfalutin terminology for what everybody calls playing around. I hate it when a manager says, oh, you're just playing around. Okay. Well, let me show you. Read my report. We'll see. And I'm not trying to sound highfalutin just for the sake of it. I'm trying to win us all credibility, autonomy, don't micromanage me, and respect. What I'm trying to do is reproduce the condition where the triangle gets outside the bounding box here. And you notice that I'm failing in that. But I'm not giving up, because one of my favorite things to do is bounty testing, especially when it comes from a customer. Customer reports, bleh. Can't repro. Or tech support gives me a call. Have you ever called tech support? Yeah, well, good. I'm in good company. They should ask you a lot of questions. Right? What operating system? What were you trying to do? Did you just install anything recently? I had the fun of sitting on a tech support call at LexisNexis my first week on the job. Last month. It was so much fun. I'm like, you guys are testers, man. I love the questions. Now, they want it to work, but they're also investigators, aren't they? And they write notes. Here's what I asked them. They have a call tracking. Okay, negative integers. Here's an issue, not a bug. An issue is something that I want to escalate for more detail, because if I file it as a bug and I'm wrong, I lose credibility. So I have an issues list. It's a safety zone, like an airlock. I don't want to commit to it yet. Now, if I'm too cautious as a tester and everything I find is an issue and I never file anything, I lose credibility that way by being too cautious. If I'm too cocky and everything's a bug, I lose credibility that way. So I have issues and bugs, right? Because there's certain things I know are bugs. I can look in the spec or the what we did before, or look on the website and see what the claims are. Those are some oracles I can consult to say, yes, we say this, we do this, they are different, desire, actual, different, bug. Whereas this one, I don't know. What should my desire be? I'm confused. An OFAT test. Look at that. I got it. I'm so pleased. Repro. I'm so excited. But I still wanted to see the boundary. I did the OFAT test, but I'm still doing it. So here is my recording. Here is my reporting. I'm doing exploration. I'm playing around. No, I'm using modeling and branching and backtracking and conjecturing and doing all this stuff. That's the demo I wanted to see. So exploration makes sense. When a stakeholder says, please investigate this bug reported by a customer, for example, a script has been executed choosing different data and re-executing. Notice this, in orange, walks up to your desk, a new build, new variations, not under the control of a script. Investigate, choose different data. That's all cognition. That's adaption. It's dynamic. I'm probably running out of time. I want to talk a little bit about session-based exploration, but doing more reports like this in a more formal way, where you have your charter, you give yourself 90 minutes, give yourself a mission, notes, bugs, issues, just make a little section there, keep some metrics there, by metrics I just mean, well, I'll show you what I mean. Like journalism, testing is questioning. Questions lead to all these things, and all these things you can get more questions. Okay? But here are the metrics. Testing is like a bird looking for worms. This is PowerPoint. Death by PowerPoint? Hell, I say. I love PowerPoint. You can make this beautiful stuff. Bird has to decide when to land, or where, and in what conditions, and all that stuff. That's one activity. If you give yourself 90 minutes to accomplish a mission, like repro a bug, or track down this Channel 47 thing, you got to decide, okay, well, what do I need to set up? Well, actually, in this case, nothing, except my camera. I can take a picture. The second activity you may find yourself doing is covering the ground. And that's test execution and design. Remember, in exploratory testing, they're simultaneous. And then you find a worm. You find a bug. You have to investigate it. It may be just the start of your investigation, not the end. Maybe just the tip of the iceberg, or maybe just the failure and not the fault. You know, developers always want us to file better bugs. Get me closer to the fault. I used to struggle with this, by the way. What's the difference between failure and fault? So I thought, well, maybe it's like this. Earthquakes make buildings fall down, and we could build them up again until the next earthquake comes along. But if we could fix the fault, literally, underneath the ground, 600 whatever miles, then buildings wouldn't fall down anymore. So that's what I use. Failure, am I reporting the building falling down, or am I reporting that there's this thing called San Andreas, and there's two tectonic plates, and they're going over each other, and that's bad. Let's stop doing that. All right. So the metrics are, let's say you give yourself 100 minutes, so 90 minutes plus 10. Then make it easy. Of that time, how much time did you spend doing setup activities? How much time did you spend doing bug investigation and reporting? How much time did you spend doing test design and execution? Okay, just try it. Just gut feeling. The nearest 5 or 10% is good enough. Oh, in this 90 minutes or this 100 minutes, about half the time I was finding bugs and reporting bugs. I found a bug and reported it versus actually trying to find the bugs. So you do this report, notes, bugs, and issues with your metrics, and you think, who's going to look at it? Well, they're going to ask you, what kind of things did you do? What were your findings? What slowed you down? Where do we go from here, and how are you feeling about what happened? Remember your audience. So your audience may ask you, what is your mission? How'd it go? How far did you get? Do you need anything? And there may be a subtext that I want you to be aware of. Like, how did it go? We've all been asked this, right? How did it go? Basically, they may want to know, what should I be worried about? Now, they're listening to your answer. They're waiting to react. All of this means that. That's all they want to know, especially as an exploratory team. Are you on top of this? Can I trust you? This is a status report. It's called a squiggle diagram. It's another way to report your exploratory testing work. A bird looking for worms. Setup. Flying around. They land. Testing. Test design. Execution. Find a bug. Woo, it's way down there. Got it. More testing. Oh, here's another bug. Got it. Test design and execution. Ideas, conjectures. Oh, wow. This one took a long time of the session to do. And I just kind of, you just look at that and say, setup, test, design and execution, and bug, STB. Gut feeling, I'd say about 40% bug investigation in this session. 30%, so I don't know how I would gauge that. But you could kind of, set up maybe close to 60%. Okay, S is 60, T is 20, and B is 20. Just a rough guess. So you can do it on a napkin, just like, here's how my session went. Okay? Also, I have a nice little HTML report. If you want to do the formal session-based test management, your papers are in order. You must speak in Russian when you say that. It scans the data from testing reports, and you can look at what you did. There's a tool that James and I wrote that parses the data in these text file reports and creates this nice HTML picture. I can, if you come up to me afterward, find me at the conference, I'll tell you more about that. Another way, this is another way to explain your exploratory testing story. And here's yet another way. From that scan tool, you can make charts and graphs about how many sessions we did per day, what's the aggregate, our TBS metrics, and provoke conversations. Tell your tactic story. Practice that terminology. Mr. Q Comp, GoRab C, RNR, modeling, conjecturing, etc. Try a session-based exploratory testing pilot with using the session concept. Okay, just try it between you, maybe just you, maybe you and another tester. No one has to know. Just give yourself a bunch of sessions, charters, and see how it works. I'll tell you more. There's more to it. I know. I'm short on time, but try a little pilot and use that proof mnemonic. Oh, I did upload it. I thought I didn't. Okay, that's the punchline. There's the fourth one. If you want to help me on this crusade, I welcome you. My dear friends and colleagues, I'm out of time. Thank you very much.